Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. We've received apologies from Marie McNair this morning, and may I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to invite Ivan McKee to declare any interests.
The interests as laid out in my MSP declaration of interest with regard to ownership of some rental properties.
Thank you very much, Ivan, and welcome to your first meeting of the committee. The second item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 5 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you, we're all agreed. The next item on our agenda for today is consideration of the following negative instruments: private residential tenancies and assured tenancies, prescribed notices and forms, temporary modifications, Scotland Regulations 2023, SSI 2023/58. Non-domestic rates, transitional relief, Scotland Amendment Regulation 2023, SSI 2023/63. Non-domestic rates, Scotland Act 2020, transitional provision regulation 2023, SSI 2023/64. And Building Scotland Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2022, Amendment Regulations 2023, SSI 2023/65. There is no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Do any members have any comments on any of the instruments? Mark.
Thanks, Convener. No comment, but just to declare an interest as an owner of a private rented property in relation to the private residential tenancies and assured tenancies regulations.
Thank you very much for that. Is the committee agreed to that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to these instruments? We're all agreed. Thank you. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on building safety. Last May, the committee took evidence from stakeholders and the Scottish Government on building safety, and the committee agreed to return to this issue on an annual basis. And we're joined in the room by John Paul Breslin, who's from Building Standards, who's the Building Standards Team Leader from Stirling Council, Local Authority Building Standards Scotland. Welcome. Callum McQueen, who's the Technical Surveying Manager, eSurvey Chartered Surveyors. Alistair Ross, who's the Assistant Director at the Head of Public Policy, Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland Association of British Insurers. And we're joined online by Nigel Sellers, who is a Senior Specialist Valuation and Property Standards from the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors. And I welcome all the witnesses to the meeting. We were also due to hear from Chris Ashurst, who's from the High Rise Scotland Action Group this morning, but unfortunately he's withdrawn this morning due to ill health. We'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible, but if you would like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks. And Nigel, if you can do this by typing an R in the chat function, we'll bring you in. There's no need for you to manually turn on your microphones, as we'll be doing that for you automatically. So I will begin with the first questions. And Nigel, actually, I'm going to direct both. I've got two questions. I'm going to start and direct them both to you, actually. But if anyone else wants to come in on these, and I think maybe they were possibly more appropriate for Chris, but unfortunately he's not here. So I'd be interested to know if homeowners and buyers are still experiencing problems in moving or obtaining mortgages due to the zero valuation of homes caused by concerns over fire safety. And if so, what impact is this having on people affected? And I'm aware also, Nigel, that you have some comments around the idea of zero valuations. I'd be interested to hear that as well.
Thank you. Can I just check everybody can hear me?
Absolutely.
In the room.
Yep.
Thank you. And thank you for having me, and apologies I can't be in the room in person. I just want to open up by just clarifying the term zero valuation. Nil valuation is actually a technical term used in the process of valuing a property for mortgage lending purposes, where a valuer is unable to provide a value at that moment in time, such as a valuer undertakes an inspection, but there may be, say, insufficient information available to them at the point of inspection. This then results in a nil valuation being applied to the property, which signals either the lender or the valuer themselves that further information is required before the valuation can proceed. It doesn't actually mean the property itself is worth zero or has a zero value. So I just want to clarify that. So moving on to the questions to how things are sort of going in the market. I think there's definitely been, in the past 12 months since the group met, more positivity in the market. The feedback that I've been receiving from RSS members operating the space is that there are valuations are taking place, lending is proceeding. And in December of last year, the RSS produced new guidance in this space on the valuation approach for properties in residential buildings with cladding. Now, whilst that guidance is specifically for England only, the intention is over time to extend that guidance to include Scotland as well. So I envisage a more positive few months ahead, and when that guidance at the appropriate time is extended to include Scotland as well, to provide more certainty for valuers, lenders, and ultimately leaseholders in the space.
Thanks very much for that. Does anyone else in the room have anything to add to that? No? OK. If you've got questions that are focused for you a little bit later. Nigel, I'd be interested to hear about the operation of EWS1, the system. Has that improved since the committee last considered the issue in May?
I'm not too close to the actual operation of day-to-day EWS1 forms. I'm responsible for the standards of setting at the RSS and EWS1 forms. I do appreciate, and I'm fully aware, that the EWS1 process in Scotland has its well-documented challenges of the tenure system, and the single building assessment will, fingers crossed, come and hopefully alleviate some of those challenges there and provide more clarity for people in this space. That's all I can sort of comment on at the moment.
Thanks very much. Callum, you want to come in?
Yeah, I was just going to say that the system over the past 12 months in Scotland as regards the use of EWS1 forms hasn't really changed. It's a lending requirement for buildings over a certain height with certain cladding materials on the outside. And that hasn't changed in Scotland over the past 12 months.
Great. Thanks very much. OK. We're now going to move on to questions around the single building assessment, and that's going to be led by Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Thanks, Camilla. Good morning. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to ask a couple of questions. Firstly, with regards to how you would rate the progress which is being made in Scotland around the government's single building assessment programme to date, and some of the pitfalls which we're seeing potentially coming forward, and why we've not seen that Four Nations approach to this, I suppose, is one of the key things I'm concerned about. And Callum, I'll maybe bring you in for your views on that.
I'm not sure why it's not been a Four Nations approach. Not been involved in that at all. But my involvement is with the valuation work that we do for lenders. Clearly, with being devolved nations, the approaches have been taken individually.
In the one case we've seen where this has progressed to remedial works taking place, there's a list of 105 other properties. I think that, in theory, is kind of the pilot of 105 properties. Mm-hmm. It's really important, I think, for householders to see the potential end of this. That one project which has managed to be complete, is there anything around that which has shown a Scottish example of being able to progress this work in a way which we can get these all firstly surveyed but then delivered?
I've not been involved at all in that project. I've just heard about it. It is good that the Scottish Government stepped in and paid for all the work, and the building, I understand, is soon to be fixed. The issue from a valuation point of view is that current lender guidance is that building will not be acceptable until the work is complete. Whereas elsewhere down in England, because of the Building Safety Act, some lenders will consider lending on buildings before the work is complete. And that's a distinction at the moment between the system in England and the system in Scotland.
Yeah. Does anyone have anything to add on that point?
I mean, I'm happy to come in and perhaps add a little bit to that. I, along with various other colleagues, including Chris Ashurst, sit on the Scottish Government's cladding stakeholder group, and so we have been involved in a number of aspects of this, including the development of the SBA. I'll defer on that to the update that the Cabinet Secretary gave in the papers for the meeting, and it's useful to see that progress set out. But in terms of the Four Nations point, building standards is a kind of truly devolved matter across the four nations. Yeah. And also you've got this challenge around the property tenure, which has delayed progress in Scotland as opposed to other parts of the UK. So I sit in an equivalent group in Wales as well, and we can maybe come on to that later if time permits and just give you a kind of contrast to the progress that's been made in that jurisdiction as opposed to Scotland. But it's been a significant amount of work's gone into the SBA. I mean, from an insurer's point of view, the SBA, I think it's a useful, it's not unhelpful as a development. When the draft was being developed, you know, we understand the perspective of taking a more holistic view rather than just looking specifically at cladding wall systems. And that's to be welcomed. You know, we discussed the details of the draft with the major property insurers in the sector, and they said, look, it's all good stuff, but that's already information that insurers will be seeking when they're coming to quote for these kind of properties. So I think it's a useful step forward. It won't dramatically change the approach of insurers because they were already seeking most of that information. But it's not unhelpful to have it collated in a single document.
Yeah, that's helpful. And in terms of the detail within that single building assessment, is there real differentiation now, though, between what potentially has happened in Scotland and in England and what that might mean moving forward? I think in Scotland we're now talking about a high and low risk. In England they're talking about almost a high, medium and low risk, and everything then in Scotland with any potential risk being classified as high. I'm concerned that, you know, we're not really on the front foot on this work in the first place anyway, but then that could potentially also present another issue for getting this work done and the cost of actually being able to meet this. I wonder if you had anything to say on that as such.
Not on the single building assessment, no. Not been involved in that.
No. And locally, no one's. And what do you think could be done to speed up then the delivery of the assessment programme? Measures, for example, the establishment of a dynamic purchasing framework to help improve timescales is what we're being suggested could help. Is there anything else you think could be?
Well, there's a lack of engineers and qualified people in Scotland to carry out that work. That's well known.
Yeah.
Clearly, if you had 20 people in the country who are qualified to do the work, you would do it quicker.
Yeah. And I know at a UK level, there's £40 million being committed to deliver that in England and Wales. I'm not sure the Barnett consequentials of that necessarily has come through to individuals who do that work in Scotland. Do we have the professionals to be able to do that work?
There are, as I say, I think there's only three or four individuals in Scotland who are qualified, who are engineers, chartered engineers, who are qualified to inspect and comment on high-rise buildings.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. I've got a couple of other questions I'll maybe come back to later.
Thanks, Miles. We're now going to move to a question from Annie Wells.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. In a letter to the committee just last month from the former Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, it noted that a walking watch has been applied in relation to two buildings. Do you believe that this is sufficient? And I think I'll come to John Paul first on that one.
Thank you. I'm aware, I've seen the media press and I read the documentation. The walking watch is there to address that the flats have got a kind of stay put evacuation, so individual flats would have an alarm go off. The waking watch is there to put in what kind of simultaneous evacuation process, so if something is identified, they have the options to then start evacuating out everyone en masse or in a coordinated phased way. So that's a kind of ad hoc arrangement, a temporary arrangement to put in place until measures can be addressed to cladding, or maybe different types of detection and alarm systems can put in. I think it is recognised as being an acceptable interim measure.
I don't know if anyone else has got anything to add on that.
No? Maybe just make the point that the waking watches, I think, as the Cabinet Secretary said in her letter, is as John Paul said, it's an interim measure.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they're looking at the installation of an alarm system in there.
Mm-hmm.
But this touches on one of the issues we may come on to later on, where I think the Cabinet Secretary refers to it as safeguarding residents and you know, preservation of life, and that's the priority there. So as John Paul has said, you can efficiently and quite quickly hopefully get everybody out of the property. But waking watches on their own won't address some of the wider kind of fire safety issues. So
to give you an example, if you have a working watch and it's triggered, you can alert the residents. They can get out, hopefully efficiently, hopefully mm-hmm. safely. The waking watch presumably would also let the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and I don't know if there's a prioritisation on calls to certain buildings that have waking watches, and they can respond and address the fire. But in the absence of sufficient fire safety measures, you know, things like the compartmentalisation systems and other measures to kind of contain the fire within particular units, you could face the prospect that people will be able to get out of the property, but the property is still significantly and extensively mm-hmm. damaged. Now, the way you're going to address that ultimately is the installation of things like automated fire suppression systems, mm-hmm. whether it's sprinkler systems, mist systems or whatever, but something that can be triggered when the alarm goes off, to preserve as far as you can the property as well as the preservation of life. So the waking watch is effective, certainly for safeguarding residents, mm-hmm. but it's not really going to do a great deal in terms of the protection and preservation of the property.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. Thank you, convener.
Thanks, Annie. And we're now going to move on to questions on the Scottish Safer Building Accord with Ivan McKee.
Thanks, convener, and welcome to the panel. I was going to indicate, I'd like to ask about the Scottish Safer Building Accord and what your view on the likely success of that is. So it would appear that some progress has been made on negotiations, but our understanding is that those have reached a deadlock between the government and developers. So really just to get your perspective on where you think the accord is and what the likely success of it is.
Well, from my point of view, from a valuation side, if the developers were to hold their hands up and say that they will carry out repairs to buildings that needed work, then that potentially could allow lenders to lend on those buildings and on flats in those buildings. And that could open up the housing market for them, because at the moment in Scotland, in these buildings, people can't remortgage, generally speaking, and can't sell the flats.
Right. And is it necessary to have the accord in place to deliver on that?
There would need to be a commitment from the developer that they would pay for the cost of the works that were required. Yeah.
Okay, any other input on that? John Paul?
From LAB's perspective, LAB's are fully supportive of the ongoing discussions and securing an agreement. We see that as very positive. I'd just like to say the Building Standards System in Scotland's made some significant changes, as we've all kind of referred to previously. And, you know, It's really improved the levels of safety within the built environment. Now, it's very critical, you know, that we keep moving forward in that regard. Any kind of work in Scotland should comply with the technical standards in Scotland fully.
Okay. So, I mean, just following on from that, when the Cabinet Secretary announced the accord, she said that if necessary, they would make full use of the powers available to us to bring parties to the table, including, if necessary, using legislation to do so. So do you think it's time for the Scottish Government to be looking at that legislative route?
I believe there is. I think it's in the document and other documents I've read. I think that is something that they are looking at, had early discussion on.
Right.
I think the existing enforcement powers weren't really envisioned. It wasn't considered at the time when they were created for this type of scenario, so it may be something completely new.
Okay. Does anyone else get any thoughts on that? Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Ivan. I'm now going to move on to a series of questions from Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Camina. Come to Alistair first. I just have a question about how the insurance industry has adapted, essentially, since Grenfell to potentially provide homeowners or tenants with affordable insurance in buildings that are clad with potentially combustible materials, and ask as well, is there a different approach to different parts of the UK, or is the insurance in the industry acting in a kind of regimented way right across the piece when it comes to providing insurance for homeowners or tenants?
Mm-hmm. No, so the insurance products that are being sold right across the UK. So it's the same basic insurance policy that you buy whether you're based in London or Edinburgh or Belfast or Cardiff. But they will need to respond to the different regimes and the different circumstances in each of the devolved nations and England, because you get different regulatory systems there. So The insurance industry had concerns about the fitness for purpose of building standards and regulations before the Grenfell tragedy. There have been a number of incidents going back to early 2000s where there had been fires that had accelerated far faster than anticipated, and there were concerns. There were some issues, in particularly around food manufacturing plants and the kind of insulation that had been used there. So there were existing concerns that the system wasn't quite working, and particularly that developments hadn't been built according to the spec of the plans and hadn't been carried out properly. The fire safety measures that were set out hadn't necessarily been installed or hadn't been installed to the correct level. And also some of the materials that were previously regarded as safe to use were actually not as safe as had been understood, and subsequent fire testing has revealed that. The tragic events and the loss of life at Grenfell brought that into very sharp focus. So after that, you saw an insurance market that had perhaps underpriced some of that risk previously, based on the knowledge and understanding that was present there from developers' plans, from the various regulations and so on and so forth. Insurers based their underwriting criteria on those. When it became apparent that those were actually no longer fit for purpose, you saw the kind of anticipated response in terms of pricing. So insurance is risk reflective. So the riskier the property is to insure because of a lack of safety measures, the more expensive it's going to be, and that's likely to be reflected in the price. So you've seen an increase in pricing, and that's obviously a great concern. The Secretary of State for Levelling Up, Housing and Communities, wrote to the Financial Conduct Authority, so the Insurance Industry Regulator, and also the Competition and Markets Authority, asking them to investigate the cost and availability of buildings insurance. Because you'd seen that the higher premiums were a symptom of the fire safety concerns, and it was becoming, there was a lack of availability and also a limit to affordability. And so the Secretary of State had asked the two regulators to look at that. The Financial Conduct Authority took that forward, and they produced a report in September of last year. And that recognised that there had been significant increases in the price. It didn't find that there was an excessive profit being made by insurers as a result of that. They recognised that the financial risk had increased, and so that was reflected in the pricing. And they asked us to go away and look at that. So the ABI was asked to lead a project, which we're doing. We'd actually already started the work before the FCA had made that recommendation, but we're working with a specialist property insurance broker, McGill & Partners, and we're also working with our member companies that write property insurance for multi-occupancy buildings. We're also working with the reinsurers there, and we are providing regular updates to the FCA and to the Department of Levelling Up, Housing and Communities, and also to Scottish Government and to the other devolved nations as well. So that work has been going on, and that's been looking at developing what's called a risk-sharing scheme. I'll maybe go into a wee bit too much detail, but it's maybe worth just getting on the record. So previously, insurance for these higher risk, high rise buildings would have been insured on what's called an excess layer basis. So, insurer A would agree to insure the first 5 million of any loss. You know, so when there's a fire or a flood or another named peril, they would cover the first 5 million of that loss. Insurer B might then come in and agree to take on the next 10 million if the claim went that high, and that would have a separate fee and a separate arrangement. And then insurer C might come in and say, well, if it's going to be total loss of the building, then we will insure up to, you know, say for argument's sake, 50 million. What that meant is that you were spreading the risk around, because some of those insurers could only take that amount of financial risk onto their own books. You know, what you're doing essentially is when you're writing property insurance, you are taking that financial risk from the property owners onto your balance sheet, and in return, you know, you're charging them a premium, so they're able to transfer that financial risk over to you. Insurers then need to make sure they have sufficient capital to carry all that risk. Now, as the potential cost of these incidents went up, that was reflected in the charges around that excess loading, so the price went up, and also the capacity in the market reduced. So insurers had less capacity to take on that financial risk because it was so much greater than was previously understood. The risk-sharing system, which we're working on at the moment and is on track to be launched this summer, is taking a different approach. So under that, one insurer would take on all of that risk. What they would then do is reinsure or cede it to reinsurers in the market. What that should mean is that the overall costs come down. It's going to be more cost-efficient to do it that way. You have to be very careful in how you construct that. It's quite a complex approach. It's got a lot of different people involved in that. You also have to abide by competition regulation as well. So it's taken a long time. It is complex, but we're making good progress. And as I say, that should be operational by the summer. At that point, you should start to see over the next 12-month period, as properties come up for their insurance renewal, you should see that reflected in the pricing. But what I should say is that this is a fixed-term response. So that scheme is likely to run for around about 5 years. The ultimate solution, the ultimate way to get insurance premiums down is the completion of remediation in these buildings to improve the fire safety, and then that will be better understood, and that's when you should see prices come back down.
Yep. That's really helpful. That level of detail as well is really helpful. Do you or your members have any indication of any properties where residents are just finding that increased level of premium before remediation happens just as unaffordable and some buildings going uninsured?
By definition, if they're not able to get insurance, we wouldn't necessarily pick up on that. I'm aware of a lot of very challenging cases in different parts of the market. Chris Ashurst would probably be better placed to comment on that, and he may want to do so at a future meeting. What you're seeing is it taking a lot longer to get that insurance in place. You know, brokers and the factors and the property agents are having to work harder to start the work earlier and have to work hard to place that in the market. You're seeing some innovative solutions coming through as well, where in some properties they're insuring each unit on an individual basis rather than insuring the entire block. But I'm not aware of properties that absolutely cannot get insurance. There are some that are paying significantly higher amounts, but that's reflective of the risk that's involved in their particular properties.
Okay, thanks for that. A question now probably for Callum and Nigel, just to ask if surveyors and fire safety assessors are still having difficulty getting indemnity cover for their work, or if that is something that has gotten a bit easier since we last covered that a year ago. And don't know if Callum, you would have any
I don't know about insurance for engineers and surveyors that carry out the actual assessments of the buildings. I don't know if Nigel's got any information on that at all.
Nigel, do you have any knowledge for that?
Not on the fire engineers, no. But I just heard anecdotally that that generally speaking, the values you're present in this space, the members that we work with, are finding obtaining insurance is slightly easier than sort of last year. But as Alistair sort of points out, ultimately, when there's certainty over remediation of buildings, that will give a more sort of comfort to the wider stakeholders.
Okay. Yep, we come in on that as well, Mark. So through the Scottish Government's stakeholder group, that's an issue that's come up in the past. And again, anecdotally, what we've heard is that the fire safety engineers are able to get that insurance. They're more often buying it now, and I think a kind of case-by-case basis for individual pieces of work that they're carrying out. So the market is functioning and is open, but the professional indemnity market more generally is quite a challenging one. And there are a number of factors to that. It's an area where there can be quite a lot of risk because you're insuring on a claims occurring basis, you know, where claims are coming back from not just the last 12 months but potentially years or even decades back. So you're taking on quite a lot of long tail risk there if you are insuring that, and you're reliant on the individuals that you're insuring, whether it's fire safety engineers or surveyors or whoever, to have a lot of good housekeeping in terms of good record keeping, up-to-date training and development records, good management of the supply chain, the subcontractors. You know, you're needing an awful lot of evidence to understand what kind of risks could be present in that business. There's been work within the industry to improve the access to professional indemnity insurance. So the International Underwriters Association has done a lot of work developing some model clauses which are drafted in a way that elicits a lot more information from the insurer for the insurers and gives them a lot more confidence so that they're able to actually take on a bit more of that financial risk that was previously unknown. But you have got, in terms of the construction sector and trades related to the construction sector, it's quite a litigious sector. There are an awful lot of claims raised. They tend to be quite complex. They can tend to run for several years once construction has been completed and go back historically. So all that can be quite challenging, but the certainly anecdotal evidence we've had is that the market, the professional indemnity insurance market, is opening up a bit and is improving. This is not a particularly Scottish or UK phenomenon. This is a global phenomenon. But we are seeing that the market is now starting to improve, and hopefully that will continue.
OK, thanks. And finally, Kimira, a question for Alistair. Again, just because you touched on your experience working on the Welsh group as well, when we're considering progress of actual cladding remediation, you know, not assessments and everything that goes before, but actual remediation, where are we in Scotland in comparison to, you know, England and Wales? I know Wales, the Welsh Government have a number of schemes already in operation in terms of the pact, the loans and different funds. Where are we in terms of progress on actually remediating the problem?
So, as we've kind of touched on already, the big differentiator in Scotland is the tenure system. And so that presents a unique set of challenges for this particular market. So Scotland's at a different point in the process. It's largely down to the tenure position. And again, if Chris Ashworth was here, I think he could probably speak very, very knowledgeably on the challenges you face in getting all the owners in a block to agree on a course of action and to commission a survey and whatever else, compared to in England or in Wales, a freeholder making that decision on behalf of leaseholders. So it's a different approach. What I would say is in Wales, there are some similarities in terms of the approach Scottish Government has taken. So both have taken a holistic approach. So it's more than just looking at cladding specifically. It's about the overall fire safety of the building. There's a number of measures in Wales that may be just worth touching on. So in September of 2021, Welsh Minister set up their Building Safety Fund. And what that has done is that's, to come back to what Miles raised earlier in terms of procurement, that has given them the option to appoint a single consultant and go direct to market, and the Welsh Government is directly procuring surveys. So rather than giving money to freeholders or to leaseholders to do all that work themselves, the Welsh Government has taken the active decision to procure, I think it's about 260 digital surveys from a single provider, and to date I think that has led to 144 intrusive surveys. And so they're making progress with that. I think the equivalent figures that the Cabinet Secretary provided for the committee were around, I think it's about 105, 106 surveys that are underway. In comparison, in England, I know that the Department for Levelling Up Housing and Communities publishes data on a monthly basis. The latest data, I think, from February, I don't know if the March data is available yet, but the February data indicated that it was something like 95% of the 400-plus properties in England that they're working on are surveys are underway. You know, not necessarily completed, but they're certainly underway. I mean, Wales has also taken quite a specific approach that where there's a what they describe as a genuine dispute over responsibility for remediation of fire safety, then Welsh Government has determined that leaseholders will not be held financially liable for that. They don't have the same legal protection that leaseholders in England do under the Building Safety Act. And again, that's a question for Scottish Government to consider, is to what extent the protections can be provided for the owners in Scotland. We don't have a leasehold system, but the owners in Scotland, and see if they can be protected. I mean, Wales has also introduced a Developers Pact. They signed that off last year, and that has secured the involvement, I think it's around about 11 of the major developers there, and they've gone from that pact to actually having a legally binding agreement now, which is supported by the major developers in that particular market. They've also introduced a Developers Loan Scheme, so they've set aside £20 million to assist developers if they need additional financial support to carry out some of this remediation work. I think that's probably aimed at the kind of mid or smaller size of the construction market, but that's available there. And again, that is a loan rather than a grant. So Welsh Government has been very clear that is a loan that has to be repaid in time. And you've also got a leaseholder support scheme. And so the Welsh Government has been concerned about the financial, but also the well-being of the leaseholders that are in flats with combustible cladding or other fire safety issues. And so they're providing independent financial advisers, which the Welsh Government will pay for, so that they can help understand their financial situation. And in circumstances where the best option for that particular leaseholder is to sell their property, either to transfer the financial risk onto somebody else or just to move out completely, there'll be support for that. And that will be supported by the Welsh Government's Development Bank for Wales. You know, it's equivalent to the Scottish National Investment Bank. And it's actually prepared to fund the purchase of those properties, take them off leaseholders, and then once they're remediated, the intention would be to repurpose them as social housing, so bring them back into the market, so you've got that capacity there. So, you know, there's some interesting approaches in Wales. That's not necessarily something that you would lift and shift for Scotland wholesale, but I know certainly there's ongoing discussion between the Scottish Government and Welsh Government about some of these steps, but Scotland's just at a different point in the process just now. Northern Ireland doesn't have the same extent of cladding problems, and also because you don't have a functioning executive at the moment there, they're really constrained about what they can do there. And in England, as I said, you've got a different system entirely, and that is making, you know, progress, and that's updated on a regular basis. I think the building safety fund in England is something like $4.5 billion, so you've got, you know, significant differences in the kind of scale of funding, but that's progressing as well.
Okay, that's really helpful. Thank you. Thanks, Alistair.
Yeah, thank you very much. Actually, those responses were really very helpful. We're now going to move on to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to you all. I wonder if I could ask some questions around standards in general, building standards in general. But firstly, do you think that the building standard changes that were introduced recently as last year actually deliver higher levels of fire safety now, and what evidence can be drawn as a committee to demonstrate that? Maybe start with Callum, perhaps.
That's something that I think John Paul would be the expert on, because okay. It's not really a valuation issue.
Yep. I'm here today as the chair of LABS. I'm also team leader at Stirling Council. I was just saying to my colleagues earlier on, we're one of the few authorities that don't actually have a building above 18 metres, just by the natural kind of environment we live in. So I've not been involved directly with the working groups that created that and worked on that, but I'm aware of the changes to the technical standards. Mm-hmm. My opinion is that it does make a significant change. The threshold being brought down to 11 metres, the most recent change about non-combustibility, that is a significant step. Also, the scrutiny that we take, the rigour that we actually look at now, the evidence we take is, as I say, I think it's the most significant in the UK.
I was going to come to John Paul anyway, Callum, just as well. I thought I'd give you a chance. Isn't the Wallace Monument over 18 metres?
Not residential. Not residential and meeting the high-rise building requirements.
Everything's got cladding
there. Yeah, I'm pretty certain of it.
It's a great point. Look, a number of issues have been raised with the committee when we previously looked at this, and with me as a constituency member. Could I just share an example with you and ask for your opinion on it? A retired person, bought a flat and subsequently wanted to sell that flat, only to discover that it had no fire safety measures and no sound insulation in the house, and is now having incredible difficulty, as you might imagine, trying to sell it. Now, it kind of fell between the debate between it's the developer, sorry, the builder's responsibility, and then, of course, the local authority to inspect and so on. So I'm in that territory of whose responsibility is it to actually assure a person who's about to buy a house that it's fit for purpose, especially for fire safety and these other measures like sound insulation. So I was going to come to you anyway on that, John Paul, to see if you could assist with that type of inquiry.
In Scotland, the current system, even with the recent changes to the technical standards, The completion submission is down to the relevant person, which is the building owner. Now, the building standards system, we take reasonable inquiry. Currently, that's a notification plan for key stages. We come out, if we don't get notification, we look at alternative evidence regarding sound, you know, if it's something that the sound standards apply to. There would be sound tests, there would be periodic inspections at certain key stages, but ultimately the relevant person is the owners or relevant person, sometimes it's a builder or a company. They are the ones who are, when they submit a completion submission, saying that the building fully complies with the technical standards. We undertake reasonable inquiry by looking at what site inspections we've done, what evidence we've gathered, what alternative evidence, if there's been areas we couldn't see, if we just couldn't get out to see certain aspects of it, that all would factor in. And if we see that meets reasonable inquiry, which is defined and there's guidance on it, we would either accept it or else, if we don't find it meets that kind of level, that threshold, we would reject it and list the reasons.
Is it thorough enough, John Paul, to find deficiencies that are as serious as that, though? Because it clearly wasn't in this particular case. So I'm wondering if whatever new standards we have introduced will give people the assurance that this kind of thing can't happen in the future, particularly for fire safety, but for other matters as well that I've mentioned, as it hasn't improved. Could that happen again, that circumstance?
Well, it's maybe coming on to another piece of work. I know it's kind of mentioned here, it's the compliance plan manager role. You know, that is forward-looking. You know, what we've talked about earlier on today is more retrospective, is looking at kind of the incidents from the past. With the new regulations, and it's one of the things that's in trial at the moment, I can talk about it later on, but that is looking at oversight from the relevant person, employing a suitable professional who's going to be looking at the reasonable inquiry the same way that building standards do. And that will be, as I say, it's in trial at the moment, but that's one of the things we're looking at, about having at the outset, very early on, engagement and dialogue about looking at the risks of the individual project, identifying what the compliance risks are, and then setting out early in the building warrant stage prior to approval what needs to be seen, what needs to be evidenced, what needs to have alternative evidence, what the compliance plan manager would be overseeing, and doing their own independent checks prior to the verifiers coming out. So there is certain aspects of it, and this is what the Futures Board Working Group has been looking at. It's one of the streams we've been working on for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. So there is improvements to be made, but we are working with the Scottish Government and trying to deliver on that. Mm.
Do you see there being a kind of checklist almost of things that should be there, almost like an MOT type certificate of compliance of construction or something like that? Because we're all lay persons buying a house, we wouldn't know. I wouldn't know if there was sound insulation in my house if I was buying a new house. So you're relying on the professionals to tell you that there's a set of things that are required and for that to be signed off, in a sense. Do we have that yet, that kind of system?
It would be a difficult one to answer. New build, yeah. You can tie regulations that were in force when something was constructed. Older properties, you know, sound insulation, if it doesn't fail to a greater degree, if it was kind of a separating wall of a fashion beforehand and it's been converted into flats, there wouldn't really be a regulation you could apply in that regard. So a simplistic list would be, I don't think it would really be possible. Certainly something that, as I say, we could, the Scottish Government and labs and other stakeholders could certainly strive towards. I can't think of an easy solution in that regard.
Mm-hmm. I mean, do you recognise that this is an issue, that's a potential issue, even going forward now, that when people do buy a house, one of their principal concerns must be, is it fire safe? And somebody should tell them that it is, and they should be able to see that in documentary evidence that it is, without opening up cavities and having a look. Surely that should be recorded somewhere to give you that assurance that the house you're about to buy complies with all these requirements. Do people get that as purchasers, do you think? Or is it through the survey process?
Yeah, well, from the building standards process, we take reasonable inquiry, but it's not something specifically for the end user.
Callum?
There's no way that a surveyor, even if you did a what we call a level 2 inspection, a more thorough inspection, it's not an intrusive inspection. These issues of fire safety usually are hidden issues behind cladding, cavity barriers, etc. The issues of sound insulation, they just wouldn't be seen. You can't inspect. You inspect a building, you only look at what you can visibly see on the surface. So those sort of issues wouldn't be mentioned in any kind of survey report unless it was an intrusive building survey. And I would assume that your constituent who had that issue was because there was an EWS1 assessment done on the building, and then a qualified person went along and had a look and did some intrusive inspections. And that's it's been commented on a couple of times that the EWS1 system has shone a light onto some of the issues in buildings. But without, you know, the developer has the responsibility for building it, the local authority for passing building control, and then after that, no one else will inspect a building and consider those matters at all, unless an EWS1 assessment is carried out.
Yeah, therein lies the actual problem, convener, that when the house was constructed, the builder subsequently went out of business and couldn't perform any remediation, and the owner is basically left with it and unable to sell it. And it's that issue I'm trying to get at here, whether we've improved that, those circumstances or not, for the public in Scotland buying and selling houses. John Paul?
I would say that the Scottish Government, it's part of one of the work streams, are looking at post-completion powers. So that's it's something that's been in dialogue for a while, but it's very early doors. It's about possible, again, I'm speaking on behalf of the Scottish Government, but kind of high-level issues about an opportunity that they could maybe do something. It's very early days, and they're still looking at the legalities of it, and whether it would be building standards or another who would be the person who enforcing it, because it could be a period of time after completion has been granted.
Do you know if there's any equivalent work going on with the UK government in this area? And I was talking about building MOTs. It was a phrase I think we used at a previous committee to try and articulate this better for purchasers. Is that a concept that makes sense to us? Do you know if the UK government are going down that route of trying to provide greater assurance to the buyers that their house is fit for purpose in regard to these issues that I've mentioned?
Not for buyers. No, I'm aware that they've extended the responsible person, who's usually the building owner or the freeholder, they've extended their responsibilities in terms of fire safety to the, I believe it's the entrance doors to the flats. But no, I'm not aware of any equivalent to what the single building assessment would be a full and detailed inspection of each building.
OK. Nigel, have you anything to offer in this regard? I realise I've not come to you yet. Have you anything you could help?
No, it's OK. I'm not too close to any sort of additional information on that from a UK government perspective. But I think there's some broader work that could be done to across industry with agents, with surveyors, with fire engineers, to actually provide a lot more sort of confidence about information around a building. So when properties are marketed, that the potential purchasers are given as much information as possible and are fully aware about what type of building they're sort of buying into. And if any sort of remediation work has been done, is underway, or any fire safety assessments have been undertaken, the information is sort of passed on to consumers at the earliest point. Opportunity. I think that sort of the whole broader transaction piece, I think that will help provide a lot more assurance to buying and selling of these types of properties.
Okay. Thanks very much, Nigel. Thanks, everybody, for your contribution. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. And we're just going to come back to Miles, who's got another question.
Yeah. There's a few questions further to the theme Willie was pursuing there, because I think one of the issues which has been raised with me was with regards to the new regulations not including schools, hotels, hospitals, and potential other high-risk buildings. I just wondered what your view was, why they haven't been included. Maybe come to you.
That's regarding the high-rise 11 metre?
Over 11 metre, yeah.
There was certain scope of which it could be applied. I think it does include certain high-risk buildings.
I think in England and Wales, they're specifically included, but I think they've in Scotland, they're still permitted to have this cladding on them.
Maybe need to get back to you. I was under the impression there's maybe certain footprint areas and things, but if it's a high-risk building, regardless of height, our technical standards say certain things can't be on them. It's got to be A1 or A2.
Yeah, I know a lot of this is technical as well when we're asking, you know, between the two systems as well. And just finally, I wondered, in terms of SMEs and what we're referring to often as potential orphan buildings, what data, if any, you have on what that looks like in Scotland and, you know, SME exposure in Scotland to that, and what could be a significant cost for these companies as well, which they might not be able to meet in the future, whether or not there's any data on that you're aware of.
From a building standards perspective, I don't have any knowledge of that information.
Yeah. Calum, you don't have that? No.
No information on that.
No. Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
So that brings us to the end of our questions, but I thought maybe I'd just open it up and see if there's anything that we haven't, and we've asked questions, but you might have something you think it's important for us to hear. So if there's anything else that we haven't covered, I'd appreciate hearing from you. Callum.
Just one comment about the Building Safety Act in England. That has unlocked lending because the government has a statute which now has a presumption that leaseholders will not pay. We don't have that in Scotland. There's no statute behind it. It's just the single building assessment. So it's obviously something that the Scottish Government haven't done. Obviously, if the government were to give an assurance about certain buildings that they were going to cover the cost, then I believe that would be considered by lenders.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah,
which bring us more in line to the situation in England at the moment.
That comes back to the need for some legislation potentially there. Yeah.
Possibly, yeah.
Anything else from anybody else? There doesn't have to be. Okay, great. So that brings us to the end of our evidence. We really appreciate you coming in to talk to us. As we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next item in private, I will now close the public part of the meeting.